I will extend Manfred's model to further particles my way. So we are discussing Manfred, which is the proper way. But should I start?
Yes, go ahead. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Okay, maybe let me reduce it a bit. Okay, so I start with Faber's model as you have listened to. So the problem is, the basic problems you would like to handle here is repairing electromagnetism, because it has two basic problems. One problem is that Gauss law can return any real number, while in nature there is only integer number. So there is missing charge quantization. Second problem with classical electromagnetism is that we have infinite energy of point charge. So the energy of electric field especially goes to infinity, and why we know it's bounded by 511 kilo electron volt for electron. So to repair these two problems, I use the Faber's approach. So first of all, we look at this this integral Gauss-Bonnet theorem, which integrates curvature of some field of unitary vectors and gives them winding the three-dimensional winding number of so topological charge in three dimensions. So Faber's approach is that we interpret this curvature, which is inside, as electric field. This way, the Gauss law counts topological charge, so we get the built-in charge quantization. So this is one basic mechanism we would like to use. Second mechanism is this regularization to finite energy. It is using Higgs-like potential. So we have unitary vectors because of some Higgs potential. So Higgs potential prefers unitary vectors, but in the center of such singularity, we would have infinite energy. So thanks to Higgs potential, we can avoid it because the unitary vectors become, let's say, here zero vector for vector field. So to avoid infinite energy, we use the Higgs potential. It leads to finite size effects for electron, and this and as Manfred has shown, they are in agreement with the running capping effect. So we need finite size effects for electron only to regularize to finite energy, and it agrees with the running coupling. So personally, I'm using the similarity with liquid crystals. So they use these fields of divided by Z2, that we don't distinguish this and this vector. Yes, so we say that this and this vector is the same. Usually, so this way, what you can see here, this is also the regularization. So this field, thanks to Higgs potential, prefers some fixed shape of the molecule. It's called Lannoy-Degensman model in liquid crystal. So I will base on that. But thanks to this Higgs-like potential, to avoid infinity, it allows to deform here. From ellipse to circle to get rid of the asymmetry in the center, because otherwise you'd have infinite energy. So these are the two mechanisms as in Manfred-Faber model. So this is can be seen close to Manfred-Faber. There are some small differences, but it's close to the Faber's model. And now there is the big question: how to get further particles? Three leptons, baryons, and so on. How to get gravity? How to get missing quantum phase? And I believe the approach I'm using is that I'm starting recognizing this twist. So I have this vector field, but also recognize this twist instead. So it is like, for liquid crystal perspective, this is like going from uniaxial pneumatic to biaxial pneumatic. So vacuum from sphere S2 vacuum, we go to SO3 vacuum, that we recognize for rotation of this molecule, this is how we imagine, but this is some real symmetric tensor field inside, and the shape is given by some preferring some set of eigenvalues, like Lannoy-Degensman equation. The eigenvalues are the lengths of the three axes. So in a Manfred-Faber approach, so we can see that you have this symmetric hedgehog, while here I'm saying that I'm starting to recognize the twist. So maybe let me switch to some animation. So here is such hedgehog with recognized twist. So one reason for this twist is that we can start evolve it. So I interpret this this spinning as a spin for electron, and there are a few reasons. So one, we need magnetic dipole moment, we need angular momentum for electron, we need the clock that Zitter-Pepegun mentioned also today, and I imagine this is the realization that the hedgehog of Mantis-Faber has additional twist and it evolves. So the question is, what propels this evolution? I'll talk about it later. So here we get through to recognition of this internal twist. I interpret as quantum phase. So we'll get additional wave equation for this additional degree of freedom of vacuum, which is similar to Klein-Gordon equation. So one reason is that we get this clock, this angular momentum, magnetic dipole moment for electron this way. Also, trying to align the second axis on the sphere, we cannot do it because of the Heribold theorem. So it can be interpreted that we cannot have naked charge, topological charge. It has to have also magnetic dipole moment. That we have to have this additional singularity of magnetic type because of the Heribold theorem, because you cannot align the second axis in continuous way on the sphere. So this is one view why I add this twist to Faber's model. Another view is that now I have three distinguishable axes. So I can perform hedgehog with one axis, second axis, or third axis, like here. So they all have the same topological charge, but different realizations. So they should have different mass. So we get three realization of the same charge. So they are similar to three leptons. So there is a suggestion that we have three families of particles like leptons because of living in three spatial dimensions. Then we finally remind that we live in four dimensions, we live in space-time. So maybe let's instead of three different axes, maybe let's recognize fourth axis. So we could go to SO4, but it's better to go to SO13, to Lorentz group, that we add some, start recognizing some tiny boost. So we imagine that there is also time that the direction, and it is nearly aligned, but tiny boost of this zero axis will lead to second set of Maxwell equations for gravity. So this way, this SO13 vacuum from dynamics, we get electromagnetics from the tilts of this axis as in Maxwell model, from twist, additional low energy quantum phase evolution like Klein-Gordon equation, plus tiny boosts in space-time for gravity. So here is some final Lagrangian I am considering now. Okay, so let's start with some topological charges. So in two dimensions, we have this topological charges that we go around this topological defect and calculate how many times the field rotates while performing loop around. So here it's plus one, here is minus one, here is plus one, here is plus two. And looking here, what we can see that it's 1/2. Because as mentioned, we divide by Z2. We say that this vector and this vector is the same. We only recognize direction. So that's a big discussion, how to get spin 1/2 in topology. So many people like Manfred tries to use 4π rotation, but I don't see it physical. Instead, there is a simpler way. Simpler way is saying that after rotating by pi, we get the same field. So we use fields like here, but we say that this vector and this vector is the same. And it allows us to get 1/2 spin without any 4π rotations. So it is in agreement with the fluxons in superconductors, with quantum rotation operators. Instead, it says that rotating spin S particle by theta angle, the phase rotates by S times theta. So this is exactly according like in this definition. So these were two-dimensional topological defects, and in three dimensions we need this three-dimensional topological charge. So we need to distinguish them: two-dimensional topological charge in cross section and three-dimensional like this hedgehog in three dimensions. So I interpret this two-dimensional as spin, as magnetic lines, and three-dimensional as electric charge. So they are different. We need to remember about it. So then looking at two topological defects in various distances and having energy, we should get Coulomb interaction as Manfred-Faber has told. I mentioned also it later. And then we have still the freedom for the clock. So we can still have this evolution of this twist as addition to what Matthew Faber has said. For the clock, governed by another set of wave equation for Klein-Gordon-like equation. Okay, so we did the similarity between electromagnetism, which means as quantization in Gauss law, and we repair it by interpreting the Gauss law as Gauss Bonnet theorem, by interpreting curvature of some deeper field as electromagnetic field. So this is Mantis approach. So we say that Lagrangian is like F mini, but interpreting F mini as curvature and dual curvature. So we dual as replace electric and magnetic field inside. Okay, so here is my candidate of Lagrangian I would like to use. So F mini, this time we fall for indexes because full curvature has four indexes. So it's still interpreted as curvature, but also includes these weights from the shapes that this kind of evolution is more costly than twists. Twists should be very, very, very cheap for quantum phase, like this Planck constant cheaper. And gravity, again, the cost of the boost should be very large. So we need to somehow put these three types of long range interactions in vacuum dynamics. So here is how it is done. So my field, my field only uses field of rotations. I'm saying this is rotation of some object, some D, like this molecule of some shape, and in shape of this molecule. So here is this shape. So this one is electromagnetic, as for Manfield has done. This delta should be Planck constant scale, so it's much lower energy cost for the twist, and G should be large cost for the tiny boost for the gravity. So thanks of that, this extension of Mantis model by recognizing twist of the object we are rotating, I can unify all three electromagnetics with quantum mechanics and with gravity, and here is this F mini full F mini if you calculate. Then it contains both R1 is the curvature Mantis has used, so this is electromagnetism. It also has this delta, so very small delta Planck constant, like different type of curvature, including the twist, and also the tilde with four gravity. So this final F mini with four indexes unifies all three interactions in vacuum at least. Okay, so here is another view. So we have this in space, we have this long molecule, like this Faber's N field, and we recognize its twist. So for example, in this momentum operator can be seen, it has a gradient, so gradient for phase, and it has a field. So in this interpretation, A is also contains some derivative of some extended quantum phase. So SO3 as extended quantum phase with twist as the standard quantum phase plus tilts as this electromagnetic analog of quantum phase to get which curvature we interpret as electric field to get electromagnetic with BT charge quantization. So we need topological to get the charge quantization. So we get unification of both and here also with gravity. Okay, so to compare it, there are these popular models, Skirmion models of nuclei. So here is some diagrams that they use. They want to model nuclei, but there are some problems. So they don't have electric charge. They, instead of interpreting topological charge as electric charge as we do, they interpret them as baryon number. So in their model, there cannot be baryon number violation. In our approaches, there could be. So this is one discussion. Can baryon number be violated? And there are examples, hypothetical processes when it is violated. I mean, baryogenesis, just after Big Bang, to create more matter than antimatter. Another example is Hawking radiation, also hypothetical, that having baryons building them into star black hole, they finally radiate in massless radiation, so we destroy these baryons finally. So this is very important question: is baryon number conserved or not? So I talk about also it later. So they use some kinetic energy with some a few terms. And potential with single minimum. So that's crucial that they have potential single minimum. So just far from this topological defect, the field should go to this single minimum. So they have only short-range interaction. So they have only nuclear force. They don't have Coulomb. They don't distinguish electron neutron from proton, for example. So what we do is a bit similar, but the most important difference is this Higgs potential, that our vacuum far from particles are still some directions, and this field of directions allows to get long range interaction like electromagnetism, and others. So example of long range quantum interaction is in Mach-Zehnder interferometer, yes, and for gravity is also long range interaction. So we need some fields, non-trivial vacuum, to transfer these long range interactions, electromagnetism, quantum phase evolution, and gravity. Okay, and then I would like to use Lagrangian as Faber with F mini dual interpretation. Okay, so I use similarity with liquid crystals because they experimentally get lots of long range interactions. So there are various articles with 1/distance even interaction, if Coulomb-Planck interaction, dipole-dipole, quadrupole-quadrupole interaction. So for example, here is, so they have prepared these two objects, topological defects, and put a camera and look at what is the distance between them after time, and then try to fit this kind of evolution. So this is time and distance, and then they can try to fit some power distribution and getting some kind of long range interactions. So they know well these long range interactions using two models. So here are the standard models used in liquid crystals. So one is Ossian-Frank, the simpler one, which uses also field of unitary vectors usually, plus some Higgs-like potential for a regularization. And the more complicated, so Manfred uses is close to the Ossian-Frank, and I'm extending to the Cylinder-Degen model, which instead needs a tensor field. That field of here 3x3 matrices is symmetric, which eigenvalues represent the length of the three axes, and eigenvectors represent the rotation, so SO3, rotation in SO3. So they use only energy as free energy, so they don't use the time derivative. Why we need to use electromagnetic like Lagrangian, with time derivatives, also with Lorentz invariants. So this is our suggestion how to extend this kind of model to get also evolution dynamics, because there is a problem with finding dynamics with these models because of no time dependence. So here this is Lagrangian you are talking, this F mini, or with four indexes where F mini is some curvature maybe weighted with shape. Okay, so here is then the Coulomb, very simple calculation of Coulomb interaction as effective. So we take two topological defects, one and second. So here are the opposite charges, here is the same charge, and we calculate total energy of such configuration. So we need to optimize the shape of this configuration, but Faber did it in this discussed article previously. I'm using the simple others here in this simple a few line calculation. So we choose some shape, which is approximation of the perfect one. Then we calculate the Hamiltonian, the energy density, integrate the energy density. It's crucial that we cut off some singularity because here you use unitary vector. So it has to be handled in a different way, these singularities. And finally, we look what is the dependence of this energy as integration of Hamiltonian over entire R^3. And we can see here is for the opposite charges, here is for the same charges, and fitting with Coulomb. So it looks nearly perfectly, but there are small differences, as Matthew has said. And so there will be some small deviations for very small distances. And as Mafia has said, they agree with the running coupling effect known for electromagnetism, that the alpha is deformed for very, very high energies. That means very short distances. Okay, so here is this regularization. So we have field of unitary vectors, but in the center it has to go here to zero to avoid discontinuity, which would mean infinite energy. So here we have the connection, which behaves like one over distance for hedgehog, curvature as the cross product, which behaves as one over R square, like the electric field. We interpret it as electric field. So here is this F mini star as the dual with exchange magnetic and electric field. And finally, with the Gauss law effects of that calculates the topological charge because of this interpretation of electric charge as curvature. So now there is this problem if electron is a perfect point. So we don't there is no any parton structure inside. The only non-perfect point here is that we need to slightly deform the electric charge not to exceed 511 kilo volt mass, so the to avoid the infinity. And as mentioned, so naively using point electric charge to get 511 keV, you need to integrate from 1.4 femtometers. So that means that cutting hole of this size, 1.4 femtometers, energy of electric field alone outside is as the mass of the particle. So it means that we need some deformation in scale of femtometers, not to exceed 511 mass of electron with energy of electric field alone. Okay, so and there is this final effect, is running coupling, that alpha is deformed for very low, is slightly larger for very, very high energy, that means very small distances. And as Mark has shown, it agrees at least qualitatively, similar order of magnitude as the running coupling. So we know that there is this deformation. For very small distances, the Coulomb force is slightly deformed. The question is how to interpret it, and we interpret it as this effect of regularization, that we need to deform the electromagnetic field not to exceed mass of electron with energy of electromagnetic field. Okay, so here are another arguments for this electron being very small perfect point. So if you search for size of electron, you probably get to this this Delmet article. So he got Nobel Prize for calculating G factor with spanning trap with very high precision in 1988, and he used this measurement to get this plot from his, here is a plot from his paper. So what he did in this plot, so here is the G factor minus two, here is the radius of particle, and he drawn three particles. So proton, you know, they knew the size as made of three quarks, triton as made of three nucleons, and there was hypothesis if electron is made of three partons. So he draw these three particles and probably first try to extrapolate with line. But if extrapolating with line, he would get negative radius for electron. So he instead extrapolated with parabola fitted to two points. So we know that we cannot extrapolate from parabola fitted to two points. We can get any value we want. So it doesn't make much sense, this argument. However, lots of people use this argument. But we shouldn't use this argument. Also, the G factor classically can also be different than one, because G factor is in fact a mean squared of density of charge divided by mean squared density of mass. So if the mass and charge distribution are not equal, the G factor can also classically can be different than one. Another argument, this time a better one for the size of electron is the scattering, electron positron scattering. So if you look, so here is such plot for GEF, so it's very high energies. So we can see that there are some resonances, but plus some nearly linear dependence. But this is for extremely high energy. So these are Lorentz contracted. So there are small, very, very thin electrons here. But while we are interested in size of the resting electron, so what we can do, we can extrapolate this line, this nearly linear behavior, to mass of resting electron plus positron. This way we get again like a 2 femtometer radius looking at cross section. So again, there is suggestion that there is this approximately 2 femtometer size deformation from electric charge of perfect point, required also not to exceed 511 keV with energy of electric field alone, and also suggested by the running coupling effect. Okay, so there are lots of experiments of Kuder. So topological defect like objects, they get various two-slit interference, they get orbit quantization, double orbit quantization, both from the main N and L angular momentum, with just bouncing droplets as classical object with wave particle duality. We get lots of the quantum effects, and aerial for topological solitons as fluxons, as because of vortex in superconductors, they also get interference, they get tunneling, Ahronoff-Bohm effects. So with topological defects, we can get a lot of quantum mechanics. Okay, so to go into electron, we need to remind that it is more than electric charge. It is also magnetic dipole moment. It has also angular momentum. For example, both are seen in the Larmor precession. Also, there is this clock, this Titterbewegung mentioned today, which has experimental confirmation. So maybe let me briefly talk about it. So experimental confirmation of this clock, this is the famous Guare experiment, 2008 experiment. I know people who try to recreate it finally because it's still, I think it wasn't recreated, but it uses high energy electrons, 81 MeV electrons. This way, the distance between ticks of this clock would agree with lattice constant of silicon. And if getting this agreement, they get increased absorption. So kind of resonance between the clock of electron and the spatial structure of lattice. So we need this clock, and having this clock is also seems suggested for the magnetic dipole and angular momentum. So this is my interpretation that we have hedgehog as in Manfred's model, but additionally recognize the tweets of this hedgehog for the both clock, for all three, clock, angular momentum, and magnetic dipole moment. Okay, so what about further particles, the baryons? Yeah, so that's the most interesting probably. So here is the Faber's electron, and now I'm extending into recognize the twist, what allows me to get from one side, we get three types of hedgehog, so like resemic leptons as the same topological charge, but different mass. Also the Heribol theorem conflict, which doesn't allow us to continuously align second line, so we need some additional magnetic singularities. For neutrinos, we need this kind of fluxons, this vortex, topological vortex, like because of vortex, but this time in vacuum. So they can form a loop, for example, and there are many similarities. These loops have many similarities with neutrinos. Also three types of loop along one of the three axes. They are extremely stable. It's difficult to destroy such loop. And we can get kind of oscillation between them. So we can transform between these three structures by internal rotation by 90 degrees. Yes, so there is this general non-intuitive problem that how they can get different masses and oscillate between each other. And here is some more classical approach to explain that indeed we can rotate between these three structures. And then baryons. So for baryons, the simplest knot of this vortex, so this kind of cross section, seems to resemble a baryon. So we have one type of vortex inside and a second forming a loop around. So why I think it's interesting, because this here is a cross section. So here is this loop around. What we can see that its field interacts with the field of internal loop. So the external loop deforms the field of this vortex inside, of this line inside. And this deformation is exactly like forming a hedgehog. And hedgehog is electric charge. So we get a suggestion that baryons themselves structurally require some electric charge. And this suggestion is very valuable to explain, for example, why proton is lighter than neutron. Because proton can just enclose this hedgehog, this charge to one, and neutron has to compensate it. So this is enforced plus charge, and it has to be compensated. What means larger size, and size will cost energy here. So it should have larger and mass energy. Yes. Then you can think about baryons, about the deuteron. So both baryons require some plus charge, and now they bind together to share one charge between two baryons required by both. I will go further, but then we can think about larger knots, and they should resemble larger nuclei. The big problem is how to bind nuclei against Coulomb interaction, and this knotting by these vortices might be some approach, especially that there we have some halo nuclei with additional neutrons, protons in very large distance, like 5 femtometers here, and having this vortex could stabilize, could allow to hold these neutrons for hundreds of milliseconds, they see in large distance. Also, you could think about some strangeness for example, by internal twist of this loop around, and releasing this strangeness would be like pion count production. So let's look again. So here is this proton neutron hope for the model. So here are a few articles about charge distribution in neutron. And usually they say that there should be positive core, negative shell in neutron. And this is exactly what is predicted by the model, that we have positive core required by baryons and negative shell to compensate this required positive core. For deuteron, it has, we know experimentally that it has very large electric quadrupole moment. So naively, how to get quadrupole moment for proton plus neutron? No, naively, it should have zero quadrupole moment. But here it's obvious. We have plus minus, so it should have a quadrupole moment. And also additional suggestion from experiment is that magnetic dipole moment of deuteron is approximately sum of the two. So they should have aligned spins. And indeed, here they have aligned spins as along this axis. This vortex, central vortex. Okay, so this model requires these topological vortices in vacuum. So the question is, are they real? So do we have some topological one-dimensional structures, lines in vacuum? So from one side, in cosmology, they imagine some cosmic strings. I'm not sure if they are true, but in science corona, they observe these shining lines, one-dimensional shining lines, magnetic, and they don't know why they are stable. There is this book, Physics of Magnetic Flux Tubes, and they say they don't really know mechanics of stabilization, why there are stable nearly one-dimensional structure. So maybe indeed there is some topological mechanism allowing for the stability. They release energy by reconnections, by shortening. Another argument for these lines being real in vacuum, so because of vortex, but not in superconductor, but in vacuum already, are these mentioned halon neutrons that we have, like lithium-11, in fact, these are 5 femtometers. We have two neutrons for a few hundred milliseconds. So how to get, so usually it says that a strong interaction, nuclear force is like 2 femtometers at most, and you have 5 femtometers for hundreds of milliseconds. So maybe this is indeed some flux on some vortex binding these two neutrons in such a stable way. There are also some different approaches. So there is this quark string, but it's a bit different. Another question, maybe in Cooper papyrus, you have coupled two electrons in cure distances, 100, 1000 nanometers. So maybe there are some coupled with some vortex to make them, to allow them to stay aligned. Okay. So let's go to mathematics for the last 20 minutes. So here is this generator of rotation. So this connection matrix general. In Faber's model, you would have only the central part, only rotation, and here we have only also added Lie algebra, of Lorentz group, so also included boost. We have this additional three. So to describe rotation in three dimension, we need three parameters inside as the generator of SO3. And in SO14, Lorentz group, we additionally have three boosts. So here is this gamma G as the three boosts. So using SO4, there would be minus here as for anti-symmetric matrix, but for boost for Lorentz group SO13, there are pluses here. Yeah, so we get this generator which combines spatial rotation and boost generator. And for electromagnetics, so this spatial rotation corresponds to electromagnetics plus phase quantum phase evolution, and dynamics of this boost correspond to second set of Maxwell equations here for gravity. Okay, so we have three types of curvatures here. So one curvature is this spatial rotation, so it will correspond to electromagnetics. We have also the purely geometric of these two boosts. It will correspond to exactly as electromagnetics, but for gravity, for second set of Maxwell equations, like here. So it's called gravity electromagnetics approximation of general. Now it is seen as approximation of general relativity, but this is just making Newton force Lorentz invariant. So we have to add this magnetic field. And it was done by Oliver Heaviside in 1893, I think. So it was before Einstein, and now it's used as approximation of general relativity. For example, the gravity probe, the best confirmation of general relativity, in fact, was confirming the gravity electromagnetic corrections. So this required by Lorentz invariants. So we have these two, electromagnetism and also interaction between electromagnetics and gravity. So there is some interaction. So what kind of interaction between electromagnetism and gravity we know? So one is that bending of light by gravity. Yeah. So it can be seen that strong gravitational field slows down electromagnetic propagation. This way the Fermat principle would also give the bending. So this is alternative view. Also, if strong gravitational field slows down the electromagnetic propagation, then all the chemistry, biology is based on electromagnetic propagation. So slowing down of electromagnetic propagation would slow down clocks. Yes. So we get also this gravitational time dilation thanks to this interaction between electromagnetics and gravity, which here is this mixing curvature. So here is the connection. The question is how to get curvature to this matrix form and commutator. If you calculate this commutator of such gammas, gamma mu, gamma nu, then we indeed get here. We get energy of this electromagnetic interaction plus gravitomagnetic internal. Plus here we have interaction between electromagnetics and gravity, as parts of this. This general F mini tensor. Okay, so here is the two equation, gravity electromagnetic equations. Okay, so here is so why Manfield has used a field of rotations alone. I'm adding this D as this shape. What is rotated, and in shape of this thing, it has three in space plus one in time. There are four parameters which should be preferred to some values by Higgs like potential. That's open question how to choose the Higgs like potential to be handled after all. So it's a very difficult question. If having working everything before, then I will work on that. And as mentioned before, so the one of them I use one, the smallest one I use zero. And one corresponds to gravity, and one corresponds to Planck constant, to have three orders, three very different types of long range interactions, electromagnetics, the quantum phase evolution like Klein-Gordon and gravity. So here is the postulated F mini shape as a commutator of the derivatives of this M. So previously here I have used commutator of this of the rotations, and now I add the shape of this rotated object, of this molecule, four-dimensional molecule. So we get really symmetric tensor field like stress energy tensor with difference of adding Higgs-like potential, which prefers some set of eigenvalues. So here you can see that this F mini, this final F mini candidate as commutator, indeed inside hides the curvatures as Manfield approach, but this time they are weighted with the shape. So we can get different energy for electromagnetics and different for quantum phase and different energy for gravity. Okay, so here is some mathematical. Some view. So here is the hedgehog with in SO3 field. So we can see that here is okay. Here is around the equator of the hedgehog, but around the one of the poles of the equator, we have this additional singularity. So we cannot the Hilbert theorem that we cannot align it in continuously. And then so we have the long axis, the tilt corresponds to electromagnetics plus the twist corresponds to quantum phase, and here is mentioned also previously that there is this we can see this SO3 as kind of extended quantum phase, having not only the quantum phase as this rotation governed by Klein-Gordon-like equation, but also the rotation of this long axis, which corresponds to electromagnetics and which topology corresponds to charge quantization, literally, and then adding to four dimension we get plus gravity. Okay, so now we have this postulated Lagrange, and now it's in three dimensions. So F mini, some norm. Okay, so here is postulated in three dimensions, and we can check that you using going back to this uniaxial, so like in Fabre's approach. In Fabre's approach, we just say that the third and second eigenvalues is the same, like zero, for example, here. And we indeed in this case we get back to the Fabre's approach that we get just curvatures inside. So this is kind of extension of Fabre's approach with adding objects which are rotated, so not only rotation but also objects which are rotated, which adds the weights to the energy of curvatures, and the weights corresponds to different energy scales of long range interactions, electromagnetics, quantum phase evolution, Klein-Gordon, and gravity. Okay, so here is some Hamiltonian. Maybe let me skip it. So some calculations. So the big problem is how to calculate something in this model. So it's very difficult to calculate because talking with Scriven people, they use trigger vacuum. That far away we have trigger field, zero field, this minimum of potential. While here the field goes it's non-trivial farther. So we have like hedgehog and so on. So that's the difficult question, how to calculate it, and that's an open question. If somebody would like to help, I'd gladly collaborate. So the basic approaches I'm using some ansatz, some for example hedgehog ansatz, trying some parameterizations, some trying to name these curvatures and get, and so for example what is done here. So here are the six generators. So three generators of, elongation generators. So this is for potential I haven't finally used. So the three rotation generators. Then here is the equation from a minimization of action. We get this kind of formula, and this is the final equation. If we using the substitution of various types of curvature as dual electromagnetic field. As Manfield Faber, so we get kind of Klein-Gordon Maxwell equation. So looking at these Maxwell equations and two projects, we can see that this equation are two projections of Maxwell equations to be zero, and one projection is a bit different, and it sounds similar to Klein-Gordon equation. Indeed, not exactly. So here is this Klein-Gordon equation. So here is the equation found, and here is the Klein-Gordon equation. So there are small differences. There is no mass. And so this is what I'm working on. So now it's massless Klein-Gordon. Having mass, I would have the clock, but this difficult how to get the clock of the particle. So I mentioned later, but this is difficult to calculate. I have a lot of these mathematical calculations, but the final one is quite difficult. And finally, it would be great to have some PDEs, some partial differential equations and the simulation, but it's very difficult to do. Also, because of these boundary conditions, we don't know to go to infinity with non-trivial field. Okay, so if we put the simplest case electromagnetic field to zero, what is here that the gammas, the spatial rotation, we put to zero, then we get similar Maxwell equation, but this time from gravity, as previously. Okay, but for gravity there is a problem because in gravitational electromagnetism we not only have different 36 orders of magnitude smaller forces, but there is also a change of sign that the same charges repel, the same masses attract. So that change of sign is quite not non-trivial to get, because if you having two sources of curvature, if you take them together down to zero, then the curvatures would be twice larger in the center, and the energy you have curvature squares. So far apart two masses and two masses together, it means twice larger energy from this gravitational field. So increasing energy with taking them together means repulsion. So the big question is how to get attraction instead of repulsion in Newton force. That's an open question I'm working on. So there are various approaches. So if you say that the there are opposite signs of curvatures, then we can get as previously for dipole attraction. But I don't think we can. Maybe so. But finally, I think the current hope to get is that looking at this Lagrangian. So here is this Lagrangian I'm using. So like here, this F mini with four indexes because full curvature has four indexes. If you look at this Lagrangian and go to Hamiltonian, then in electromagnetics going from Lagrangian to Hamiltonian, we change signs to or pluses. Yeah. So here is electromagnetic Lagrangian going to Hamiltonian. We have only pluses through the Legend transformation. But if we do it here for four indexes, we only get pluses for two indexes for the corresponding to the derivatives. So this Hamiltonian has finally negative contributions also. It has both positive and energy contributions. And there are so usually the most important are positive. So here is this electromagnetism. So here is this F mini, the final F mini. So we can see that here is the R1 mini. This is electromagnetism as in Faber's approach. So this is standard electromagnetism, Faber's electromagnetism, plus this delta, this Klein-Gordon-like first evolution electromagnetism. This is also with energy. There is some interaction here between electromagnetism and gravity electromagnetism. And also we get these terms, these which are, have negative contributions, but are very difficult to activate. So in theory it could go down, but it's very difficult. So how to get it? So especially this term is very, very interesting, that gamma one is exactly this twist, this phase evolution, and this is some gravity. So having only this term and not this term, then we would have, you could get some negative energy contributions, and this way I get some clock that this constant rotation of electron is energetically preferred. It cannot be too fast. The speed should be optimized, I think, based on the atomic scale, and also we get some negative contribution which allows us to hopefully to change sign for the gravity to Newton attraction, but this is still a work in progress. But I think this is quite promising. Okay, and here is the final slide. So here is the final slide. Okay, so we know the standard models. This is Lagrangian standard model. It is huge, and this is not predicting of the model, but looking at experiment and getting new surprise and adding the term according to the surprise and fitting the parameters. So it is not a very nice model. So maybe it is like effective model. For example, some Taylor expansion of some deeper model, some much smaller model. So it would be great to have some deeper model, which effectively as Taylor expansion leads to this huge standard model Lagrangian. That's the hope general. I hope not only mine. So this is my my candidate, my hope, I think it's promising at least. So it's just generalized extended electromagnetism from one side to include charge quantization because of this F Heitz curvature. Also to unify all three, not only we have not only electromagnetism, but also Klein-Gordon for the phase and also gravity. So it indeed unifies all three. And some Higgs potential, I don't know the details. I only know that the minimum what should be. And it leads to this all three vacuum dynamics, unifying all three interactions, long range interactions. We build charge quantization with regularization to his potential to finite energy of charges and other more complicated objects. If three leptons from three spatial dimensions, same charge, different mass, non-zero magnetic dipole moment because of Helibor theorem, three neutrinos like these loops, very stable oscillations in beta decay, then it should be produced. The families of baryons, and especially with this intuitive, not quantitative, for unfortunately now, explanation why neutron is heavier than proton, because baryons require some electric charge, proton can enclose it, this hedgehog, and neutron has to compensate this electric charge. For the binding energy for deuteron, because both want this needs this charge, and now they can share with one charge, what leads to this electric quadrupole moment, which is known experimentally, and the spins are aligned. Nuclei are actinoid, not so. So there are lots of problems with nuclear faults, and there are lots of heuristic models which we don't want to work. So maybe it's worth to go in this direction to consider some real vortices inside. Especially for these hard neutrons in distance larger than of nuclear force, very stable binded. So hopefully, finally, after calculating it, looking at quantum field theory, hopefully the Lagrangian will get somehow close to the standard model Lagrangian. Okay, thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you very much for a very great and inspiring talk. So please, now there is a time for questions. Please have some questions.
Jarek, can I ask?
Sure.
You spoke about this pi rotation in the first part of your talk, and you connected it to, you related it to the spin 1/2.
Yes. So this is very standard interpretation also in liquid crystals. So instead of saying that we need to rotate everything by 4 pi, it is sufficient to say that after 2 pi, the objects rotate by pi, but it's the same object after pi.
This would, according to my understanding, would rather look like integer spin and not half integer spin.
So if you use field which is symmetry like S2 divided by Z2 here, then you have fractional charges, topological charges.
Make a symmetric configuration, a bisymmetric configuration, and but how would you explain then spin 1/2 plus spin 1/2 is spin 1 or spin 0?
So if you add these kind of configurations, then the same. This is exactly the same. This is still a winning number. If you look around, this is winning 1/2. If you look at the quantum phase rotation operator, this is exactly in agreement. Rotating it, this system by some theta angle, the phase rotates by theta times 1/2.
Thank you.
Do we have any more questions?
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Hello.
Go
ahead. Jarek, please show the slide where you have been talking about the liquid crystal model.
So all the slides are about the liquid crystal model, so I'm not sure.
Yes. Which one. So happens that I was forced to share my attention to
some standard liquid crystal models. Austin Frank and Rano de Gans.
Mm-hmm. And what about, because I consider sometimes some analogies, because you have been talking about the liquid crystal models, okay. And what about the situation when such when such crystal, liquid crystal, we have phase transition, for example, what would be the consequences to your theory?
So I think this is so it's a bit different the regime than phase transition. So and phase transition would require modifying the parameters, and here parameters are constant. I look mm-hmm. only at topological defects, uh-huh. constant parameters. So this is kind of different part of liquid crystals. So usually most people work on phase transition liquid crystals, but there is also this new field of the topological defects.
Uh-huh.
Ivan Smaljuk, Ingo Dierking, Samo Kral, and a few others. And they experimentally get these topological defects, and there are no phase transitions in this kind of system. So they assume there is one phase, and we don't change it.
Okay. And what about the situation when you have the fixed-like potential, yes? And such potential, this very well known fact, has two degenerated vacua. And for example, whether there would be possible to set up another potential, for example, with three degenerated vacua.
So here in 3D, the vacuum is the basic vacuum is S2. So it's not 2 points, but just entire sphere, maybe divided by Z2.
Uh-huh.
So these are continuous vacuum.
Uh-huh. Okay, thank you.
Yes. Uh-huh. And so I for uniaxial, you have S2. For uh-huh. biaxial, you have SO3, maybe divided by Z2.
Yes.
And then I extend further to SO13, gravity.
Okay.
Maybe I have one more question. Jarek, could you tell us, if you have, let's say, two scattering electrons, let's say there is emission of electromagnetic waves due to this process, can your model of electron can account scattering in two dimensions in all aspects?
So it's a very difficult question. So the basic so here is basic calculation that we have the Coulomb interaction, but finally we have energy has to be maintained, and yes, indeed, this energy, as you say, should be radiated somehow. But it's an extremely difficult question. So and getting the two photons or three for depending on ortho or para positronium, so it's very, very difficult. So and also we argue with Manfred, should the this quantization is some topological quantization of the number of photons, or maybe it is only in these processes like the emitter absorber like atom, or here very, very specific process of annihilation, but it's very difficult, so I'm not there yet.